Israel Finkelstein is a leading figure in the archaeology and history of ancient Israel. Over 40 years of fieldwork and research, he has helped to change the way archaeology is conducted, the Bible is interpreted, and the history of Israel is reconstructed. I sat down with Israel over several sessions to talk about how a lifetime of work has informed the story of ancient Israel. Hi, Israel. Welcome back to the Albright.
Hi, Matt.
Today we're talking about King David, continuing our discussion of the United Monarchy, which we began last time. We've seen that the figures of David and Solomon are possibly historical, but they would have ruled from small highland villages in the southern highlands, similar to the situation that we've described for the Amarna period. You have argued that the description of the United Monarchy is rather a description of a kingdom to be, an ideological construct or manifesto of later kings reprojected onto the past. Today, let's look at the biblical description of David. As usual, we'll look at the perspectives of the broader ancient Near East, the archaeology itself, and of course, the biblical text. So let's start with a short introduction. Why don't you begin with, help us understand why we should consider David as an historical figure at all.
Indeed. We have already mentioned it before. David is an historical figure, according to my understanding. And my understanding comes from different angles. The first one is the reference to Judah as the house of David in the Tel Dan inscription. This is significant because there's this king of Damascus, probably Hazael, writing in the second half of the 9th century and referring to Judah as the house of David, which means that he acknowledges that David is the founder of the dynasty and, let's say, sitting in the capital of Jerusalem. And this is the genre of the time, similar to the Assyrians referring to the northern kingdom as Beit Umri, the house of Omri, acknowledging that Omri was the one who founded the capital Samaria, the capital of the northern kingdom. So this is one reason. I would also say that the very strong memory of David in the biblical text, the very strong tradition of David, I find it extremely difficult to see it as some sort of a later invention. So according to me, there are enough arguments to claim that David is an historical figure. Now the question, of course, the next question should be, when exactly did he rule, for how long, and what was the territory? And we already spoke a little bit about it before, but maybe it's good to repeat now that we are pinpointing, focusing on King David. So the Bible says 40 years. Of course, 40 years is a typological number, so it only means many years. We can only say that David ruled sometime in the 10th century. The whole context of the story is in the 10th century BC. He ruled from Jerusalem. He ruled over a limited territory, apparently, in the highlands, in the southern highlands. And you mentioned in your introduction correctly, I think, that we can compare this to the situation in the Amarna period in the 14th century. The meaning is that the 10th century in Jerusalem is still an Amarna situation, which means a still continuation of the conditions in the late Bronze Age. So he rules over the southern highlands, Jerusalem to the south, Hebron, the fringe, the southern fringe, perhaps the margin of the Shephelah, perhaps a little bit to the north of Jerusalem, not far more than this. So this is the background for the rule of King David. And if we indeed wish to illuminate the biblical description, we need, as usual, to turn to archaeology, to ancient Near Eastern text, and to biblical exegesis.
How would you describe Jerusalem in the time of David?
Jerusalem was still a small town. I think that it was the mound, the original mound of Jerusalem is on the Temple Mount. So it's impossible to investigate, of course, but looking at the overall picture of the 10th century, the finds from the 10th century, even away from the Temple Mount, on the margin, on the slopes, in the city of David, the finds are limited and give us good reason to argue that we are still, also from the point of view of the nature of Jerusalem, not only the extent of the kingdom, we are still in an late Bronze Age situation, in a Marna situation with a small, relatively small town ruling over this landscape in the southern highlands.
Okay, let's start with the biblical materials, in particular the books of Samuel, where our story comes from.
I think that modern research, the point of departure of modern research is in 1926 with a study by a German scholar, a biblical scholar, Leonard Drost, who analyzed the story of David in the two books of Samuel and divided them into two blocks. The first block is the rise of David to power, and the second block is the succession history or the court history. The rise of David to power describes how David came to be the ruler, the founder of the Davidic dynasty in Jerusalem, including the takeover of Jerusalem. And the court history or the succession history is the story of the struggles within the court of King David for the succession, which means who will be the one who will sit on the throne of David after him. It leads to the King Solomon sitting on the throne in the beginning of the book of the first book of Kings. Now, Rost understood these two blocks as having been written in real time in the 10th century BC in order to provide legitimacy for David and Solomon, which means there were voices against David and there were voices who argued that Solomon was not the first to the throne, so he is not legitimate on the throne. And the stories came to explain what exactly happened and legitimize, first of all, King David, cleaning him from any wrongdoing, and legitimizing Solomon on the throne. And Rost says, if this is the case, of course, the legitimacy was necessary in the 10th century BC. So he pinpointed on the 10th century. One of the reasons was, you know, in the early days of research, before archaeology came to the scene big time, one of the reasons was that Rost looked for inner information in the biblical text for scribes in the time of David and Solomon. And indeed, this can be found. There is one of the verses regarding the court of David describing a scribe sitting there, and also there is a description of a scribe during the time of King Solomon. So Rost, of course, said, okay, here are the scribes, so we have evidence for writing in the 10th century. It's not necessary to mention that this is some sort of a secular argument that we need to avoid if we can. So this was the theory of Rost. And the problem with this theory, there were several problems. The first one, indeed, was that one cannot engage in a circular argument like the one I mentioned a second ago, and that the archaeological evidence that has accumulated since the days of Rost shows very clearly that there is no ability, at least in my opinion, for composition of complex literary texts in the 10th century BC. And please remember that Samuel, the book of Samuel, is the ultimate literary text to differ from chronistic information, let's say. The ultimate one is the book of Samuel. So a text like this could hardly be composed in the 10th century BC. Not only that, there are reasons to argue that the story of King David, as put in front of us today in the biblical text, was composed in the final stage, or the final stage for the Iron Age, because there were later editions, of course. But the final stage for the Iron Age in the 7th century BC, in the late 7th century, in the time of King Josiah. So we are 3.5 centuries away from the time of the historical King David. So what do we do in a situation like this? We need to look at the text as an accumulation of traditions. We need to deploy biblical exegesis, of course, always, archaeology as a very powerful tool, and records of the ancient Near East in order to try to excavate the story of King David, which means to peel it off layer by layer and to see different horizons from different periods in the story.
We've spoken a lot about literacy in ancient Israel. We've talked about different kinds of texts, elaborate literary texts, and earlier types of texts as well. I think we'll need to devote an entire session to writing in ancient Israel. Now I want to turn to the biblical text. Rost spoke of two blocks in the David story, and you're looking from an archaeological point of view at the text, at multiple layers in the text. How many layers do you see, and what is the earliest?
Difficult to say, to describe the number of layers. I would say that it would be reasonable to speak about four layers, and I'll explain later. The earliest one is is the authentic one, is the one which presumably really depicts some sort of an atmosphere which fits at an earlier time, closer, in the time of King David, but closer to the time of King David. I'm speaking about the parts in the first book of Samuel where we get this apiru ambiance, apiru atmosphere. Just to remind our viewers who were the apiru are groups mentioned in ancient Near Eastern texts and especially in the Amarna period in the 14th century BC. There are outlaws who are active on the fringe of the organized kingdoms, and they are suspected always by the central regime as troublemakers. They can serve sometimes as sort of mercenaries. And the description of David as a leader of a band of people acting on the fringe of Judah, the southern fringe of Judah and the western fringe, in a way, is a typical description of an activity of an apiro group. Just remember, there are two scenes which demonstrate this in the most beautiful way. The first scene is the story about Nabal and Abigail. King David comes in the southern fringe of Judah, south of Hebron, in an unruly area, so to speak. He comes to Nabal, he asks for protection from Nabal, and by doing this, he also takes his wife with him. So this is one example of really activity of an apiru group of maybe several hundreds of people, as the Bible describes it, enough to be significant on the in the situation of the 10th century BC. A second story, which is even more instructive, is about the town of Keilah. In the book of Samuel, there is the story of the town of Keilah. They are asking David to come to the rescue because they are being raided by the Philistines. And this story of this band coming to rescue the town of Keilah, if we locate Keilah, Keilah is located in the Shephelah, very close to the highlands, on the margin of the territory of Philistine Gat, in fact. And here is exactly the situation that David is maneuvering on the border coming to the rescue of Keilah, the same situation we have a big fight over the identity and rule in the town of Keilah in the Amarna period, between the ruler of Jerusalem and the ruler of Gat. So we are in the same situation, if you wish, a very interesting parallel going back and forth between the 14th century BC and the time of King David. And the 14th century is instructive because it provides us with real-time evidence written in the 14th century BC, something very unique. So this is the background. And the arena of operation of this apiru gang moving there in the southern highlands in the 10th century BC, the arena is the southern fringe of Judah. Some of the places mentioned in the Rise of David to Power story are in the south, Ziph and Gedi on the shore of the Dead Sea. The story of Nabal takes place at Maon, which is south of Hebron, on the desert fringe, if you wish. And then there is also the fringe, the western fringe, the border between, the territory of Jerusalem and the territory of the Philistine cities in the lowlands, in the Shephelah. And already in the late Bronze Age, we hear quite a lot about these frictions between the highlands and the lowlands, between Jerusalem and the cities of the lowlands, especially Gath. So over there in Adullam, in the valley of Elah, where David fights Goliath, these are places that we need to pay attention to. On top of the apiru ambiance in this early layer, as I see it in the story of King David, There are two chapters that we need to, I think, to refer to here. They appear all of a sudden in the Book of Samuel in two separate chapters, as if the author forgot to put something in, and then he collected stories and put them in groups. These are the heroic stories of the people surrounding King David, the heroes of King David. And these are the atmosphere in these stories is also kind of unruly. And some of the stories are really funny, like the heroes going to bring water to King David from the well at Bethlehem, and the fight against the hero or the enemy who had six fingers in each hand and six fingers in his legs, 24 altogether. So these stories in the two groups in chapter 21 and 23 are also, in my opinion, coming from this early layer. The early layer, what characterizes the early layer, it is that there is no theology, there is almost no God in the stories, there are no speeches of prophets. These are heroic stories in the typical genre of the old world.
How would you date this earlier layer?
The dating, this is quite fascinating, because here archaeology can be of great help. The most important city of the Philistines in the early David cycle is Gath. Gath of the Philistines. Goliath is also a Gittite. He comes from the city of Gath. And other stories. Achish, you know, is the king of Gath, to whom David runs away. According to archaeology, Gath was the most important city of the Philistines, and probably one of the most important cities in the land of Israel, in Canaan. Starting in the second half of the 10th century and continuing into the 9th century. Yet, it was attacked, assaulted, and destroyed completely. In the 30s or 20s of the 9th century, which means in the second half of the 9th century, by King Hazael of Damascus. So, presumably, the stories should be dated before the destruction of Gath, because after, there is strong evidence that Gath never came back to be, you know, an important Philistine city in the Shephelah. We need also to look at the story and see what is the town which is not mentioned, because we know that in the Iron One, before Gath, the most important city of the Philistines was Ekron. And Ekron prospered in the Iron One, which means in the, say, 11th century BC and the first half of the 10th century until it was destroyed. So we are caught here, and Ekron is not mentioned in the cycle of David at all. So we are caught here in between the destruction of Ekron and the destruction of Gath. I would say between the middle of the 10th century and the second half of the 9th century BC, as the backstage of the story from this point of view, from the point of view of the Philistines. There is another point that I think we should look at, and this is the settlement pattern in the southern part of the highlands of Judah, south of Jerusalem, let's say in the area of Bethlehem, in the area of Hebron. We today, as a result of the intensive surveys that have been conducted in the highlands, we possess the temporal maps, the maps for the different periods of activity. So we can see that in the Iron One, in the, let's say, 11th century, 10th century, the territory is very sparse, very sparsely inhabited. And this is also true probably from the beginning of the 9th century. And then something happens. And within the 9th century, in my opinion, in the second half of the 9th century, we don't have the time now to go into the details of pottery to describe why I'm saying this, so you have to trust me, Matt, about this. In the second half of the 9th century, we have all of a sudden this expansion of activity, the first expansion of settlement activity in the highlands south of Jerusalem. Why am I mentioning this? Because I'm getting back now to the Apiru atmosphere. One cannot think about Apiru atmosphere anymore when the settlement becomes dense and the administration of the capital is strong and it is possible for the king to rule on the fringe of his territory. So this atmosphere, this apiru situation is impossible in the highlands of Judah, south of Jerusalem, after the middle of the 9th century BC. So again, this supports what we have just said about Gat and putting the background, the stage setting behind the early David cycle in possibly late 10th, beginning of the 9th century BC.
How would you describe kind of David's machinations during this period? What's he doing? And
By the way, there is another support for the story being earlier than late monarchic times, in the sense of the toponyms mentioned. In the story of the rise of David to power, there is a set of toponyms mentioned which do not appear in late monarchic lists, such as the very detailed list of the towns of Judah in Joshua 15. So this should also be taken into consideration, kept in mind in the background. Now, what does David do there? This is also interesting. David is this leader of this band, maneuvering on the fringe between several powers. He is not there alone. There are several, well, powers maybe is too strong a word, but several entities, territorial entities, and David is typically maneuvering between them. One is, I'm speaking now about the story, the biblical story, but it is supported by archaeological findings. One is the kingdom of Saul, on which we spoke a while ago in one of our conversations. This is in the north. The center of power of King Saul is to the north of Jerusalem, in the area of Gibeon, Gibeah, but also, I mean, of course, according to the story, Saul is active also to the south and west of Jerusalem. The second entity is the entity in the Shephelah, Gat, the strongest of the Philistine city-states. And this reminds us, as we have already mentioned, of the situation in the Amarna period, of these clashes between the highlands and lowlands, between the city-states of the highlands and the city-states of the lowlands. However, there is another entity for which we have information both in the Bible and archaeology. In the Bible, in the story at the end of the book of Samuel, the first book, of David distributing the spoil of Amalek to towns which are located farther to the south even than the fringe of the power of the entity of Jerusalem. And from archaeology, we know about a territorial entity, perhaps we will speak about it in one of our next conversations, which is centered in the Beersheba Valley. This is a desert polity which rose to power and importance because of the copper industry in the Araba to the south of the Dead Sea. So they are also in the story, and David is typically maneuvering between the three of them.
Are you already in this early segment of the story associating David with Jerusalem?
Jerusalem is the most difficult nut to crack, so to speak, in this context of the story of David and Saul, because regarding Saul, there's always the question, if Saul rules from this plateau to the north of Jerusalem near Gibeon and is acting to the south of Jerusalem, he must be ruling also one way or the other in Jerusalem. And then the story is, or another question is, who rules in Jerusalem in the 10th century? I am not sure that we are in the situation today to give an answer to this question, but in any event, there is the tradition of King David taking over Jerusalem and making Jerusalem his capital. So the story is what? The story is of this outlaw acting on the fringe, unruly group of people, band. They take over Jerusalem. So the meaning is they take over the traditional hub of domination in the southern highlands, in the southern part of the central highlands of Canaan.
Okay, that was the earliest David. Next time we'll talk about the later layers of the David story. Thanks, Israel.
Sure.